You know what I love most about Mars? They still dream. We gave up.
Terraforming, creating a new world for life through technology. In my last video, I talked about whether it would be technically possible to terraform Mars, but just because science can, doesn't mean that science should. Our good friend, Elon Musk, says we should colonize and terraform Mars as soon as possible. So let's talk about the pros and cons of terraforming Mars, and think about whether it would be a good thing, ethically speaking. But first, if you enjoy this video, make sure to let YouTube know by liking, subscribing, and leaving a comment. So we could technically terraform Mars. It would take, maybe, no more than about 100,000 years. We just have to warm the surface, melt the ice, create a breathable atmosphere, and seed the planet with life. How hard can that be? We'd have then doubled the number of planets that humans can live on. Why should we bother? I mean, think about it. It would be a massive intergenerational engineering project that would require huge amounts of resources and time and energy to pull off. The payoff would have to be really, really worth it when you think about the opportunity cost of the other things that you could do with all those resources, time, and energy. I think the benefits of terraforming tend to be easier for people to think about, apart from obviously the cost and the effort involved. So we'll start there. But there are some pretty serious downsides to terraforming Mars that I want to come back to because I think they're often ignored in this discussion. Elon Musk is pretty well known for making the argument that we should colonize Mars as soon as possible in case something goes wrong on Earth, like an existential risk, like artificial intelligence or a comet impact or nuclear war or something going really, really wrong. This would give humanity a backup so that we could keep flourishing in the event of a disaster on one planet. If you think that extinction on Earth would be bad, then there is some validity to this argument. A stable population on Mars would give us a chance of humanity surviving if something catastrophic were to happen on Earth. But for some existential risks, a colony on Mars wouldn't actually make us any more resilient. If artificial intelligence goes really wrong, for example, you're probably just buying yourself a few more years. If the goal of terraforming Mars is to create a backup for humanity, there may be more efficient ways to do that, like through creating space habitats. In the super long run future, completely mining a lifeless planet and turning it into space habitats would get you more bang for buck than terraforming the planet as a whole, because there's a lot of material inside the planet that doesn't get used. If you want to see me make a video on space habitats, then please leave a note in the comments. Colonizing Mars and creating a stable population would be hard, but terraforming Mars would be even harder. If you could create a stable population on Mars without terraforming it, or maybe by para-terraforming, where you create a dome and just terraform everything under the dome, maybe that would be easier and maybe that would be enough. If you think that having life on Earth is a good thing, then you probably also think that having more planets with life is also a good thing. Nick Bostrom's cosmic endowment idea argues that we're missing out on a lot of value by not spreading life throughout the galaxy and throughout the universe as quickly as possible. Colonizing and terraforming one planet would be a reasonable place to start. There are also some benefits that future colonists on Mars might get from terraforming. It might reduce the cost of living there because you wouldn't need to maintain an oxygen supply. You might need a little bit less radiation protection. Now, this is an interesting one because you might ask, well, okay, even if someone is fully self-interested, why would they support terraforming? They'd be long dead before terraforming ever takes place. But there is still an economic path to self-interest here. Let's say you own land on Mars. Well, if someone starts terraforming, the value of your land might go up because someone expects the land to be worth more in the future. It doesn't actually matter whether the person buying it would see the benefits either, it's just about the expected future benefits. Eventually, for someone who owns that land in the future, it's going to be worth more, so it's going to be worth more now. This was a concept that was explored in the Night's Dawn trilogy by Peter F. Hamilton. Investors may fund a first colony to a new world, even though that new world wouldn't export any resources or goods for hundreds of years, because they know that in 30 years, if things are on track, then they can sell their stake in that planet for a profit. Because someone else would then sell it to someone else and someone else, and eventually that person would be gaining benefits from exporting the resources from that planet. I've already mentioned the opportunity cost, because if we're spending resources, time, money, etc. on terraforming Mars, we're not spending those things on other things. That's an opportunity cost. Elon Musk himself estimated in 2016 that it would cost about $10 billion per person to send someone to Mars. If you spent $10 billion on some of the best philanthropic opportunities there are today, you could save almost 2 million lives. That's the trade-off that we're looking at here. On the other hand, to be fair, the costs of space travel are dropping over time, so the numbers may look different in 10 years. The opportunity cost doesn't make terraforming bad per se, but relative to other things that we could do, it might not be the best opportunity. Maybe we just build a permanent base on the moon and call it a day. It would be a lot cheaper and be kind of as good. Okay, let's get a bit weird now. Stay with me. The life of your average animal living in the wild is probably quite terrible. Wild animals have to deal with being hunted by other animals, starving, being too hot or cold, parasites, disease, injury, and so on. It's awful. And for the many species that tend to have hundreds or even thousands of young, so that some of them survive to adulthood, most of them would die very young and very painfully. Because in a stable population, only about 2 animals would survive to adulthood per parent pair. So do we really want another planet full of wild animals suffering a lot? In my last video, I talked about how terraforming Mars might require installing a biosphere by introducing phytoplankton, zooplankton, and then fish to a young Martian ocean. Introducing certain life to Mars, like insects and fishes, might be very hard to reverse without making the planet uninhabitable for humans as well. So we should be really sure that doing that is a good thing before we do it. It's a huge moral judgment call to be making. There are some other important ethical considerations that don't neatly fit under the benefit or the cost buckets, but I think are still very important to talk about. So imagine it's the year 2100 and you're a second generation colonist on Mars. Your parents migrated to Mars and they were owners of a small colony in the northern lowlands. They passed away and now you own most of the colony. Your home is a series of interconnected modules and you make a living by selling bulk iron ore to the main colony in the south of Mars. Then you find out that Elon Musk III is starting a great terraforming project and your home will be underwater in the next 50 years. Should you have a say on whether Mars is terraformed? Yeah, right? Probably. But most of the people living on Mars live in the southern highlands and would benefit a lot if Mars was terraformed, so they want it to go ahead. What happens then? It's an interesting scenario to think about. Maybe the government of Mars, if there is one, would pay you to relocate, similar to how we pay people to relocate if there's a large infrastructure project that would otherwise go through their house. A lot of people think that it would be just flat out wrong to terraform a planet if it turned out to have non-sentient microbial life on it, and that therefore we should keep the environment pristine. But I'm not so worried about this. What makes something bad unless it's bad for someone? Just as I have no problem with stepping on a rock, I have no problem with stepping on yeast or some bacteria on Mars. Some worry about contaminating Mars, either because of the loss of scientific value or just because it's intrinsically bad to do so. The scientific argument I can certainly buy, but I do think that the other considerations would probably outweigh this one. And as for the intrinsic value of Mars being pristine, I just don't buy it. I mean, who would that be bad for? If there are some people who would just rather not see Mars terraformed for intrinsic reasons, and some people who would, how do you resolve this? In any case, just like some rocks from Mars have arrived on Earth over the years by being blasted out into space by impacts, at the rate of about 500 kilograms a year, by the way, it's plausible that some rocks from Earth have arrived on Mars with some small amount of microbial life still present on it and already contaminated the planet. But let's say that we have a pristine planet. We know that it's never had microbial life on it. It doesn't today. But if a planet has a reasonable chance of developing life in the next 100 million years, should we leave it alone? Where do we draw that line? Ethicists continue to debate these kinds of questions even today. Which brings us to our sponsor for the day. Just kidding, I don't have a sponsor. Please sponsor me. You might be thinking, well, this is all very fun to think about, but this is basically science fiction. This is never going to happen in reality. In my last video, I talked about whether it would be possible to terraform Mars from a scientific perspective, so you might want to go check that out. I'll see you soon.